Are we going to start the webinar now?
Okay. Welcome everyone to Samuel Sekuritas Indonesia's webinar with Medco. We have with us now Mr. Roberto Lorado as the CEO of Medco and Mr. Anthony Mathias as the CFO of Medco. Allow me to introduce myself. My name is Rinaldi Wijaya. As Samuel International's oil and gas analyst. Today, I will be hosting the webinar accompanied by Rita Effendi, an investment consultant from Indonesia Investment Education.
Hi, good evening, Rinaldi and everyone. Thank you so much for being here. Hope we all stay healthy and safe. As we are aware that crude oil prices have recovered from their COVID-19 slump and driven by firming demand, which can be considered as a speedy recovery from the oil market. Commodity prices are also rising across the board, and there are multiple reasons for the broad rally. So it's a wonderful opportunity for all of us here to be able to hear from Medco's board of directors in regards to the company's latest performance and future prospects. First of all, disclaimer, every discussion here is only for reference or consideration and not a buy or sell recommendation. Every profit and loss is the responsibility of the capital market investor. Without further ado, let's start our discussion today. And Rinaldi, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Rita. On this special event, we have several agendas as follows. First, I would like to introduce our speakers and then followed by the company profile video for 5 minutes. And then we'll go to the presentation about 20 to 25 minutes by Mr. Lorado and Mr. Mathias. Okay. So Mr. Roberto Lorado has been the CEO and the member of the Risk Management Committee of Medco Energy International since 2015. Before that, he was the President Director of Premier Oil Indonesia from 2010 to 2015. Managing Director of ENI Indonesia from 2006 to 2009, President and CEO of Vico from 2003 and 2006, Managing Director of AGIP UK from 2001 to 2002, and he is also an active member of the IPA Board of Directors since 2006 and was elected President of the Association for 2008 and 2009. Mr. Anthony Mathias, he has been the CFO and member of the Risk Management Committee of Medco Energy International from 2015. Before that, he was the Vice President of Finance and IT of Premier Oil Indonesia and held various positions at Premier Oil from 2012 to 2015. He was also at ConocoPhillips and Mobil Oil from 1999 to 2012. He was also in Pricewaterhouse in 1990 and GEC Marconi in 1988. Okay, so we can now start with the company profile video. Please enjoy.
The world needs energy now, tomorrow, and in the years to come. Countries want to grow. It is therefore pivotal to acquire, secure, and manage resources. And it is here where we, Medco Energy, are contributing, investing in the future of energy and natural resources industries. We are a large group of companies with strong multidisciplinary capabilities, trusted to own and operate large and complex assets, oil and gas, power generation, mining. Hailing from humble beginnings as a drilling contractor in 1980, we have been promoting growth for decades. Sustainability is key. After years of organic growth and a series of acquisitions, we have become one of the leading energy and natural resource companies in Southeast Asia and beyond. We now operate at a large scale in reserves and production, driven by technology, innovation, cost leadership, and HSE best practices. In our power generation business, we aim to produce cleaner electricity with gas and other renewable sources such as geothermal, hydropower, and solar. We participate in one of the world's largest geothermal development, Sarula, and are responsible for their operations and maintenance services. We are also operating one of Indonesia's largest power plant and bring electricity closer to remote communities with our mini hydropower plants. We are also engaged in copper and gold mining, providing jobs and business in a less developed region and uphold the highest international standards. We understand that sustainability is key. Therefore, we strive to balance business objectives and sustainable development goals, moving towards world-class operational excellence with cost management, operating efficiency, asset integrity, as well as health, safety, and environmental protection as its pillars. We employ technology and logistics management to reduce fuel consumption and GHG emissions. Asset management is integrated with operations to safeguard our investments, people, the environment, and reputation. And we have regreening and biodiversity enhancement programs in place to offset our carbon footprint. Sustainability is key, and so is growing together with the communities. Medco Energy realized from the start that we needed strong local human resources to develop our business. We seek and employ the best available talents in Indonesia and beyond, and provide inclusive, challenging, and rewarding career paths, work environments, training, and education programs. We were also aware from our beginning that we needed to be socially responsible where we operate. We provide help in education, healthcare, economic empowerment, and environmental protection. We are also not afraid to go the extra mile, helping to select better varieties of organic rice and even building a regional general hospital. Our efforts are monitored and evaluated by global consultants, helping us to adhere to international best practices of ESG and management standards. The world needs energy to grow, to build a better future for everyone. Medco Energy is at the forefront of the efforts of balancing the interests of all stakeholders and being a prominent player in Southeast Asia and beyond. We aim to be the energy company of choice.
Okay, now we can start with the presentation. Mr. Lorado and Mr. Matias, the floor is yours.
Pak Tony and Roberto, you're still on mute.
All right, okay now?
Yeah, this one's okay.
All right. Okay, thank you. Apologies for that. So again, good evening to everyone, and thank you to Samuel for organizing this event, which is, I think, one of our preferred priority events we like to attend every year, especially when it comes to introduction and the explanation of our results, annual results. Now this year, we come to this event a little bit later than usual. As you probably, most of you will probably know, OJK this year granted a 2 years extension to the deadline to submit the annual results in order to take into account difficulties, logistical difficulties related to COVID. Well, we had our own logistical difficulties, sometimes or not always able to mobilize people as we wanted, and therefore we have decided to submit the annual report a little bit later than usual. However, in the meantime, we also progress the Q1 results, which are pretty much final and will be ready to be issued by the end of this month. So we thought for this presentation this year, different from other presentation, that we would introduce you to both the Q1 results and of course the 2020 results, but with the Q1 also results and some guidance towards the end, because we thought it might be useful for you, for investors, especially a Q1 that comes after such a difficult year like 2020, a difficult year for the energy industry, of course, a difficult year for all individuals affected by COVID and the COVID pandemic. Now, if we can look quickly at the next slide, please. Can we move to the next slide? Yeah, just 1 minute on the contents, just to give you a little bit of a flavor of what Tony Matthias and I will be presenting today. So I mentioned Q1 update, okay, COVID response, of course, 2020 summary, results and guidance, what to expect in 2021. When we look at the layout of this presentation, you will see there is a new entry, as we say, which is ESG progress. I'm sure this is no surprise to the audience that ESG matters have become such a prominent feature for all companies, especially companies engaged as METCO is in the energy sector. As we address ESG, then I thought maybe worthwhile spending 1 minute about what we mean by that, and especially what we mean by energy transition strategy for our company. Now, the video, introduction video, already gave, I think, a good description of the three key business segments of METCO Energy today: the oil and gas, the power generation, the mining. How we got to this portfolio structure, this is the result, of course, of 5 years of restructuring, during which we've been rather proactive in terms of acquisitions. We more than doubled the production of our oil and gas business. We've taken full control of our power business with an intention to further develop it. And also acquired an important interest in mining, which essentially is copper. We also done a number of disposals. So the whole portfolio rationalization has been an area which has kept us very busy. And for whoever is interested, there is a slide summarizing all those transactions somewhere later in the presentation. Now, three legs, therefore, which I think somehow represent our energy transition strategy, in the sense that we started earlier on diversifying our investments from the original core oil and gas into renewables via METCO Power. I mean, the presentation already highlighted our presence in the geothermal, which is expanding, as we will see later during the presentation. A presence in the renewables, which is now also expanding into solar. And we have some, not large, but interesting presence in the hydropower. We also have an interest in mining, which essentially is copper. Years ago, when we were, maybe the first presentation, we were asked what had mining to do with an energy company. At the time, we say that we regard the company as part of a broader energy story, being copper such a key element of the upcoming growing push towards the economy, electrification. I would say with insight that overall, our reading of the developments, future development, was about right. And I would say that as much as today there's so much pressure and questions about energy transition, what we're doing, I would say that we have already positioned our company to actually be proactively investing in green energy. But then when we talk about energy transition strategy, of course, there's another leg, which maybe is today the leg that is taking, when it comes to reporting and attention by media, is taking maybe prevalence. And that is the ESG part. You know, ESG means environment, social, and governance. ESG really is the part that looks at emissions, at our footprint, at our management of environment and climate. So again, you could read the energy transition strategy under two legs. There is the leg of how we diversify into green energy. Yes, we have started, and we will probably do more in future. How we committed, are we METCO committed to adhere and apply the best principles, industry principles in terms of ESG? Yes, we have. This is a journey we started years ago. We have hired international consultants years ago. And if you look at our sustainability reports, the next one is going to be coming out in a matter of months. You will see the journey we have done. That is the leg where we address the request from public media and investors on showing commitment on the environment and towards decarbonization of our operations. And so that's where we, as other companies, are working in terms of reducing emissions, improving efficiency, switching to, when possible, to cleaner fuels, enhance our stewardship on preserving the ecosystem where we operate. Hence, we think it is only due and natural that we are going to have not just to maintain and improve our commitment, but also to communicate more on what we are doing in this area. So let's therefore turn into and have a quick look at the Q1 update. Next slide, please. So production, we can start from the top. Production of oil and gas is for Q1 around 100,000 barrels of oil equivalent, which is steady, consistent with the average production last year. First message here for the oil and gas. What we see today is that for the 2021, the oil and gas production will be below 100. Which is slightly different from our previous guidance. What we are seeing is that there is a remaining of weak demand, weak gas demand in key markets. In our case, is Java, also Singapore, where we are facing competition from LNG. The result of this is that our best guess today for the 2021 production is at 95,000 barrels of oil equivalent. In terms of power, instead, power sales are steady and during the year will grow up as soon as the Riau project is completed. The Riau project is at 275 megawatts in Sumatra, which has already reached 98% of completion as we speak. But even more interesting is when we look at MPI, is which is our platform really for investment into renewables. It's interesting to see how power generated through renewables, geothermal, mainly today, some hydro, but coming up also solar, already is over 30% of the power generated. Again, just to put a number on our exposure and the investment on greener energies. After a very, very difficult year, 2020, where the average oil price was around $40, now we have seen a remarkable comeback at the end, towards the end of last year in Q4, with average which was already at 50 or above. And as we speak in Q1, and I will speak in these days, as you know, the oil price is hovering between high 60s and even into the 70s. Consensus is, I think, that for the next 6 months at least, the prices will remain at this level. In order to mitigate, however, possible effects of low oil prices, and these are decisions we made mid last year, earlier this year, actually, we continue our hedging program. We are currently hedged 12% of our 2021 production, and Tony Matthias will provide you more details on the program we have put in place. At the end of Q1, cash and cash equivalents, I think we are in a pretty healthy position with almost $700 million. The consolidated debt is now at $2.7 billion. On this area, I will leave it to Tony to elaborate more on details. Ratings by the agencies have been confirmed, so Fitch and Standard & Poor's have revised stable, and by the end of this month, we will also have completed the review with Moody's. Another important message from this slide, I think, is the progress we're making with Medco Power. As I said earlier, Medco Power is our chosen platform for renewables investment, but of course, the core and still prevailing business is in the thermal gas fuel of power generation. We made on this last year a decision to try and foster the future development of this area, which in Indonesia has great opportunities. We decided to try and bring in an international player to support the strategy and the future development of Medco Power. And we are also, of course, very pleased that Kansai Electric, one of the major utility companies, international utility companies, decided to join us in this strategic alliance where Medco Power will retain 60% and Kansai will take a 40%. So this alliance will really pretty much focus on the thermal business of Medco Power, including the O&M segment. All the investments we are doing and we will be pursuing in renewables are outside this alliance. On the mining side, you will have seen that for 2020, Amman contributed positively to our bottom line results, because now in 2020, eventually they came to mature and develop the phase 7. As we speak, however, they also started the development of phase 8, even though phase 7 development is far from being completed. This is a bit of a strategic decision by the management of Amman in order to optimize the different phases, to optimize cash flow management, to avoid to have these big ups and downs in terms of revenues, capital investment, and especially cash flows. This is progressing well, and we are very optimistic that the current high prices for copper and the high demand that we are seeing in the world for copper will really help maturing, bringing more value to our portfolio. As part of our ESG efforts, we have enrolled in a carbon disclosure project, and is again one of those international efforts to bring more disclosure, more accountability, more coherent planning, I would say, towards efforts that we and others are undertaking in terms of decarbonizing the way we produce energy, and through that to help mitigating the effects of climate change. Next, please. All right. It will be difficult these days to start any presentation or to go really to do any presentation without addressing what has been a major emergency for us all last year. And as we know, it's still ongoing. We are not out of the woods. We are all sort of relieved that looks like the pandemic in many parts of the world is now under better control, and especially the vaccines seem to be working properly and are now becoming widely available across the world. Now, as a company, from the beginning last year, we put in place a very strict protocol in order to prioritize health and safety of our workforce and communities and protect the operations of our company. And we are, of course, very pleased to be able to report that last year we did face no operation disruption, no major operation disruption from COVID. As I said, strict protocols and also some not immaterial financial commitment to ensure that those protocols will be effectively in place. We have spent around $7 million in 2020 only to ensure that those protocols will be in place, that we will be able to assure proper and secure transportation, quarantine, testing, and assistance to all of our people, office-based and especially not office-based, around and even within our activities. We are also in coordination with the SKK Migas and other government agencies. We are also progressing our vaccine program for employees and contractors. And I don't probably intend really to go through all this slide. And again, you will see through that all the actions we put in place on both sides, the workforce, but also in terms of community support, community donations and the support, for example, to schools and students who were so greatly affected last year have been quite high priority for us and for the Medco Foundation together with us. Now, during this period, we've been operating with the vast majority of our people working from home in remote. We are now looking at starting bringing some of those people back into the office. But before doing that, we are really refitting. For example, in Jakarta, we are refitting our offices to ensure that we will be able to offer a protected and safe environment. As well, actually, introducing Helpdesk and other measures to take into account the fact that maybe, possibly in the near future, we will not be bringing everyone back to the office. So as part of this program, we have obviously made certain decisions to reduce our office space, and where appropriate and we have actually pursued some cost reductions in that respect. For example, we have closed some office in Jakarta, some office space in Jakarta, as well as we also closed the corporate offices of Ophir around the world, Bangkok and London, as per program for our past acquisition. Not much else to say on this one, but wishing for everyone, of course, that we will be able, we as a company, as a community, and together with the government, we will be able to navigate through these difficult times and get at the end of the tunnel, which I am right now certainly much more optimistic than I was a few months ago. Next slide, please. All right, this is an executive summary of our 2020 results. So again, as you will see, production was 100, as we mentioned earlier. Sales more or less in line, pretty much in power sales in line with our expectations, slightly down actually because of poor demand. Certainly this year was characterized by substantial drop in oil and gas prices and reduced energy demand, reduced gas demand for our gas contracts below, in a few cases below take or pay. However, take or pay contracts were in place, effective, and we actually have received cash, some $37 million as a result of those contracts being in place. So yeah, reduced production, but the downside protected and received some substantial cash. The gas that was not sold is still in the ground and we will be able to sell in the near future. Consolidated EBITDA at over 500 million, again, down 20% year on year, but with a high margin. The EBITDA has certainly been helped by, I would say, an energetic action in terms of cost control. We activated last year as soon as the effects of the oil price collapse and the pandemic became manifest. We reduced overall cost by over $200 million last year, 120 of which in CapEx, 90 in OpEx. So as a result of this, we actually were able to more than offset in terms of cash availability, we are able to more than offset the revenues reduction. While we were, of course, reducing CapEx and activities, of course, we had a number of commitments, however, which had already been undertaken, especially on exploration in Natuna and in geothermal in the EGEN asset. Now, luckily, I would say all of this exploration has been successful. And we made 4 commercial discoveries in Natuna, EGEN, is now a confirmed discovery, and we are now in the phase of appraising its potential. As I mentioned earlier, Amman turned profitable in 2020, and of course, helped by the improved copper prices is rise to a lot of optimism about the value of this asset. The Riau IPP, the 275 megawatt power plant that I mentioned earlier is reached mechanical completion last year, but as we speak now into towards the end of, well, into Q1 and Q2 now, completion today is at around 98%. So in a few months' time, we will see COD of this important asset. Last year was also a year where we had a successful rights issue, which further confirmed the high level of support from our shareholders. It was a successful rights issue, which was obviously very useful in balancing our financial situation. I will not comment on debt because I leave that to Tony to take care of. And actually, I think this is probably the right place for me to hand over to Tony to take you through the rest of the presentation.
Thanks very much, Roberto. Maybe we could move to the next slide, Roberto. I see that a lot of questions have been coming in on the live chat here. So what I will try to do is, as we go forward, I will try to address the questions in the material. Yeah, apologies if I won't call out your name and the specific question, but let me see if I can provide you answers when I go through the material. So as Roberto said, 2020 oil and gas production about 100,000 barrels a day. Higher oil production, but gas demand below pre-pandemic levels. So one of the questions I think was, how did we manage to increase oil production last year, but gas production was lower? Oil is an international world market, of course, right? So we will sell every drop of oil that we can produce. What we don't control is the price. During last year, when the pandemic hit in Q2, yes, there were certainly were rumors of an oversupply of oil and short storage around the world. So there were concerns at the beginning that potentially oil fields might have to be shut in because there was just no one wanted it and there was not enough place to store it. In the end, that didn't happen, certainly in outside the United States. I mean, it seems like a long time ago now, but in Q2 last year, WTI, the price of the American benchmark, actually did go negative for a while. And it was because nobody wanted the oil and there was no place to store it. So they had to pay people to take it away. For Brent and internationally, we have been producing oil and we've been selling it, but accepting the market price. It's still the best value decision not to shut in production. For gas, our gas is sold in Indonesia point to point effectively, and also our gas internationally. We sell to a specific customer along a pipeline. We don't sell on a spot market. So our gas demand is a function on what our customer asks us for. The customer has an obligation to take a minimum gas level in the year, in the period, and that's cool. That's what Parabata referred to as the take or pay level. They have to take a certain minimum, otherwise they pay us anyway, because we spend a lot of capital to put these in facilities in place. We need a guaranteed return. We don't want our customers to go and buy gas cheaper from somebody else and not take our gas after we've spent our capital to put pipelines and wells, gas plants in place. On the other side, so there is a take or pay minimum. On the other side, we have an obligation to deliver up to a maximum, a higher number, if our customers call for it. And that's what we say is our capacity to deliver. So that's why we were able to produce more oil last year than the previous year. But our gas demand, despite the fact that we bought Ophir, so like for like, we have more gas plants, more gas wells, more facilities. Our gas production, gas fell because our customers didn't ask for as much. As Roberto says, it's still in the ground. We'll deliver it in the future. And to some extent, we've received prepayment for that gas. That's the take-or-pay system to ensure that we get a return on our investment. Other comments, I think, on oil and gas before I move to power are around our $215 million of CapEx in 2021. How will we fund it? Our liquidity is very strong. As I think Roberto summarized, we have almost $700 million of cash. And our ongoing capital needs, the $200 in oil and gas, will be funded from ongoing operations and ready cash. So there will be no additional debt sought to fund that. I see a question here on impairments last year. We booked a loss, as you many of you will know, I'm sure, of $130 million at 9 months last year. And then at 12 months, we booked a loss of almost $190 million. And in the quarter, we booked $90 million of impairments and write-downs. So that Q4 last year, on an operational basis before impairments, was actually a positive net income. However, given the state of the market and the uncertainty going forward, we decided to take a very conservative view of a number of items, and we took impairments. We took impairments on oil and gas, around $25 million. Not that large compared to some of the larger E&P companies around the world. The traditional E&P write-downs that when prices are low, we were not overly exposed. We have taken write-downs before, but we have a very aggressive DD&A policy. So not a large level of E&P only write-downs. We also took positions that in 2021, we are going to relinquish some licenses acquired during our Ophir acquisition. So we took write-downs of the commitment and the investment on those licenses. We're not going to move forward with them with future developments. So we expensed the work we had already done on those assets. That's another $18 million. There was a write down of our part of our investment in the energy building, almost $29 million, I think, impairment on the energy building. So not related at all to oil and gas, but related to, of course, for all of these write-downs and impairments, we employ a third-party valuer. So OJK regulations, we need a third party to produce an independent valuation. On that valuation, our property business, we wrote it down. Fundamentally, why did we write it down? I think you get a clue when Roberto talked about closing one of the, or releasing a building that we rented for our Ophir staff in Jakarta and moving them into our headquarters building. I am sure that many of you are not working in the office anymore. You're all at home. And I'm guessing even the Samuel staffs with virtual backgrounds, at least some of you are dialing in from home, right? And it's the case, I think, for all property businesses around the world now. People have proven that we can work from home. So there won't be full-term occupancy in our buildings anymore. We have released some floors in another building, moved those people into the energy building, and also released some floors in the planning to release floors in the energy building. Hence the valuation of property you know, you have to question that going forward. And so we took an impairment. So the question follows on then to say, are there any impairments in 2021? Given Roberto said the prices in Q1 21 were $58-$59 a barrel. Those of you who follow the news will see that we are at the high 60s a few days ago in the 70s dollars a barrel on Brent. And copper prices continue to be strong. In that environment, if that environment continues, I think very unlikely there will be impairments in 2021. If I can move on now to talk a little bit about power. Generated sales.
Mr. Mathias. We'll have a separate Q&A session after. So due to our limit, maybe you can go through the presentation. And then after, technical analyst would go through his technical view on macro. Thank you.
Okay. All right. So that's a polite way to say hurry up, right? So let me...
No.
Let me move. It's okay. It's okay.
You're being very insightful on. And it's very helpful, Mr. Mathias. So please go on.
So Meco Power, 2,500 gigawatts sold last year, about a third from renewables and the Kansai Alliance, as Roberto mentioned. I think he didn't touch on the new, I think he spoke about Riau and Igen. And then we also have a PV facility, a solar facility we're building in Sumbawa. And I think let's touch on this HOA with Pertamina Geothermal too, to jointly develop a number of geothermal fields. You saw, I think, probably saw or heard about an aggressive target by the government of Indonesia to be carbon neutral by 2060 and to expand dramatically the use of renewable energy over the next few years. So this is a strategic move, I think, to agree to work with Pertamina Geothermal on a number of potential geothermal fields in Indonesia. Aman, a lot of questions. I deliberately avoided 90% of the questions in the chat room on Aman. Legally, of course, at the moment, we're very limited in what we can say about Aman. A lot of speculation upon IPO and very strict rules in Indonesia and other places on ensuring that all parties get equal access, all potential parties get, shareholders get equal access to information on Aman. So very little we can say, given the speculation and the high copper prices. But as we look in 2020, as Roberto said, great news to see profit again in Aman, and that in Q4, Meco Energy was profitable. And also great news to see that they are able to progress a phase 8 and not leave a large gap between developments, as happened under the previous owners of the asset. Right? We had large gaps between phase 6 and phase 7. Next slide, please. Let me move on and make some key points. And all this material is available on our website. So we won't have time to cover it today, but you can go and see these points. It's available on the website under our investor section. A couple of points there. You see the EBITDA impact very clearly of price of last year, price and demand. And then the statement, net income was positive, adjusting for those write-downs. Next slide, please. I see we only have 10 minutes left, so let's go. Gonna go very quick. Looks like a little bit of delay on that technology. Deleveraging. Leverage is good, right? Particularly when interest rates are low and you have, you use it for specific profitable value adding applications. Given that we have, there is a lot of speculation in the world about potentially rising interest rates. Despite the cash and price situation last year, with the cuts we made to expenditure and with very supportive shareholders and thank you for that, we were able to reduce our leverage and reduce our financing costs in order to make space, in our profit. And with shareholders' help and some proactive liability management, we do not have significant debt maturities for several years now. You'll see we have almost 700 million in cash. Rupiah bonds for 2021 are also already secured in escrow. And then you look less than 350 million of maturities over the next 2 to 3 years. Next slide, please. ESG, yes, I don't want to overplay this item, but it is clear that the market is moving. You know, you saw the Indonesian government, as I said yesterday, committing to renewables in the future. The market is moving, and we get questions from funds, fixed income funds and equity funds, almost certainly every month. The market is moving and expectation for funds is growing. We need to make sure that we stay current with regulation and in our practices so that we continue to be investable by these funds. If we don't stay current with the market, these funds will not be able to invest in METCO. And for a sustainable future in energy transition, we need to continue doing what we started in 2015-16 when we bought Aman. As Roberto said, the reason we bought Aman was around copper and energy transition. And you can see, I won't go through the details, but you'll see the direction on these charts is all positive. We're staying current or ahead of the market. And our practices are, I would say, based on MSCI, I think there's a little MSCI ratings in the right, in the top right-hand corner. We are best in market, best in region for some of our ESG practices, as they call it. Average for the world, but best in region on a number of our practices. So we can continue to be investable for these funds. Next slide, please. Long delay, I think. Here we go. Guidance for next year. And it's some important points. On production, I think it's the responsible thing to do, given we had a couple of unplanned downtime in Aceh. Planned downtime and then extended downtime in Aceh. And then Vietnam, also some unplanned downtime. And then we have weak gas demand. It seems odd that we're 101,000 barrels a day at the end of the first quarter, but we're signaling that full year we may be below 100. And I think that's the responsible thing to do given where we see gas demand. If gas demand improves, things could be different. On the far right of this chart, you see a column called production capacity. The height is 110. So Roberto talked about, yes, we have a take or pay commitments from our gas buyers, as in they have to take a certain amount, and if they don't, they pay. The opposite side to that, our obligation is that we need to be able to deliver 110,000 barrels a day if our gas customers ask. The liquids will sell what we produce. The gas is subject to our customer requirements down to that take or pay level. Next slide, please. Maybe while the slide is turning, I'll just comment on hedging. It's still a lot of volatility out there in the market, but we have a hedging program to protect us. Guidance on cost. We always say less than $10 a barrel. There's a question I see on do we have a target to be lower? We don't give a target to be lower. You know, in our industry, to cut costs at no matter what is not good practice, given you know the nature of our industry. So we maintain costs below $10 a barrel, And we retain our core values, particularly on ESG, in environmental and safety. So below 10, I think is enough of a guidance. Capital, given that we have flexibility to respond to gas demand, we do not want to overinvest. Yes, we want to be able to capture the upside on pricing, but short term, we don't want to overinvest either. Hence our view of capital. Slightly, I mean, very slightly above where it was in 2020 and significantly below 2018 and 19. Next slide, please. I think perhaps I will stop here. I think this is just a recap of things we've already said, and perhaps it would be better in the interest of time, hand over to Samuel, and then to cover any Q&A.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Lorado and Mr. Matias, for the very insightful presentation. Now we can go on to William for the technical view. William, if you may.
Thank you. Let me share the screen first about the... Yes. Okay. Okay, hope it's clear enough there. Look, when I check this oil price on this chart, it seems like it's still testing the resistance of 71. So as you can see, this is the resistance that's very valid from 2019, and it has not broken up yet. If it's broken though, I will add this target price to at least 85. But as you can see, this is quite a very strong resistance. So it's still consolidating at this point. I will see this chart of oil. It may not go straight directly up. So if it goes still consolidating, I want to see the narrow range between 65 till 70. As you can see, this is the range of oil for the last 2 months, as around April, May, and June. So okay, 3 months then. So we have to be patient here because the uptrend line here is still solid. Yes, it's still solid, but it doesn't mean it is a very strong uptrend at this point. So I'm still stand at the consolidating situation, but hope for breakout anytime soon. Now, about the METCO, when I check METCO, it's actually testing the support here, around 660. So assuming the support holds, you see the resistance for METCO, the target price should be around here, 730. And when it breaks up again, we could assume that the next target should be around 790. Of course, that's all assuming that the support level holds. The risk here, of course, when the support level here does not hold, it will break down and the next support level should be around here, 600 to 610. So I'm still quite optimistic here that the support level will hold. So I will see this support and this resistance, this range that should hold for the METCO prices in this kind of chart. So I think that's what could I take from technicals. So return the table to you, Eng.
Thanks, William, for sharing your view on the technical of oil and METCO. We will now proceed to the Q&A session. I'll start with my own question, and then maybe Rita can read off the questions from the audience. My question is, can METCO share their view on the oil price trend in 2021, given the current demand and supply situation, and with the potential geopolitical risks? And what's your assumption on forecasting for oil price?
Right, and would you also provide us with a ball or a sphere in which to read the future? Really, look, as I mentioned earlier, actually, I mentioned that, I don't know whether also Tony repeated. I think the consensus we see from the analysts is that for the next 6 months, oil prices will stay possibly the current level, right? Because the demand is starting recovering from the economy picking up, countries opening up. Last week I was in Europe and I really could see firsthand how the economy is opening up again. I know there will be possibly maybe ups and downs, but certainly Europe is on that path, and even more so, I think, America. So my expectation is that this demand is going to pick up. But as we know, oil price, yes, reflects demand, but it's not that we are short of oil around the world, right? There are countries which have large reserves and potentially excess capacity they could play. And that's what happened last year when we had an immediate crash, sudden crash of prices. So I personally don't feel like I can, I wouldn't venture into that area. I would say that we as a company tend to be, I think, reasonably prudent. And as much as we look at the consensus, our planning and our investments are made on the basis of a price which is substantially lower than the current oil prices.
All right, thank you, Mr. Orado, for sharing your insight on oil price. Maybe Rita can continue with the questions from the audience.
Okay, we got several questions here. So this is from Brian. How is METCO reaction on the world's first green energy island in Denmark? And how do METCO have a plan in the near future of building windmill as a power plant?
Well, about the energy, about this new island of Denmark. Look, there are main projects today around the world, right? About decarbonization and about increasing the availability of green energy. We are not chasing every single project, really. We are looking at what we can do with our portfolio and especially what we can do in Indonesia. Is wind an opportunity? Well, we are looking at that, but we have no immediate plans for any development in that area. We are not seeing, at least in Indonesia, we are not seeing the right opportunities yet, but we've been looking at proactively. We are going to do more solar. Yeah, we mentioned in the presentation this 26-28 megawatt project in Sumbawa, but actually, we already signed two contracts for the development of another 25 plus 25 solar farm in Bali. There are certain administrative matters that need to be solved, but hopefully we will be able to confirm that project in a few months. And then, of course, there is geothermal. Geothermal is not an easy area to operate. Has a high degree of subsurface risks to deal with, but on the basis of the experience we have matured with Sarulla, the successful exploration that we have conducted in EGEN, now also, and that has given us comfort, for example, to sign an HOA with Pertamina. The Mina Geothermal to look together with them on that area. Okay, that is an area I think is realistically practically of interest for our company. So geothermal, solar, wind, I don't know. Hydro, we're doing a little bit, but I think really geothermal and solar in the foreseeable future.
Okay, thank you. Very impressive response from you, Mr. Roberto, since we got a very limited time here. So maybe Rinaldi would like to give some closing statement for the audience and for the management of METCO.
Well, okay, I mean.
Actually, we got some more questions, but it seems.
I was thinking they were, okay, as you wish. Tony, you want to say, is there anything You had a look at the question, Tony. Is there something you would like to add before we close?
I think many questions on Aman, which unfortunately, given our legal position, We cannot, again, would not be fair to provide limited information, right? In any corporate action, if there is to be one, there will be a prospectus and all shareholders will get equal information, or prospective shareholders will get equal information. I think for maybe a couple of questions I saw, clearly for Aman, it is a long-term hold for Metco. The level, well, it depends on the future, but we entered in 2015-16 as part of a strategy of energy transition. You'll notice at the same time, we began a renewables program and a reforestation program. So Aman is a long-term hold for us. The level will be subject to the future and subject to the market. But cannot say anything else on Aman. Many operational and detailed questions which cannot really answer at this point.
Well understood, Mr. Tony. Since we got a message that you have another meeting, so we are very sorry that we have to end this meeting. So Rinaldi, do you have any closing statement for our meeting here?
Yes, thank you again for Pak Roberto and Pak Tony for having this webinar, especially for our client, retail client. Thank you for taking the time this evening to have this webinar. So without further ado, I know that we have a message here that you have a board meeting right away. So again, on behalf of Samuel Securities Indonesia, we thank you very much for this webinar. Thank you.
Okay.
You're welcome.
Thank you also.
Good to see you. Good to see you on the video back.
I know. Good to see you, Tony.
Thank you, thank you to all getting these, and a special thank again to Samuel Securitas for
meeting
this.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, everyone.